name is Councillor Anita Leech and I am the chair of the committee. Can everyone hear me okay for that? My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly, having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate right is the Councillor Solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the Council's Planning Officers, Highway Engineer and Environmental Health Officer, who will present the applications this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people who you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualified petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if the petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they will not be able to return to take part in any debate that may be followed by the committee. The application will then be opened up to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on this application. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee, this matter will not be discussed this evening and will be discussed at a subsequent planning committee meeting. Once I've actually announced if there are any planning visits, if you want to leave, you're able to leave, but you're also okay to stay if you want to stay. Okay, committee, could I have approval for the minutes on pages 1 to 14, please?
Yeah.
Thank you. Are there any declarations of interest?
Thanks, Chair. Item 9, the applicant is known to me, so I won't be participating in that particular item.
Thanks, Chair. Any requests for site visits? Joe?
Thank you, Chair. Can I have site visits on items number 7 and 8, please?
Any others? Are members happy to approve those site visits?
Thank you.
Okay, the first item on the agenda is... the site visits for agenda items 7 and 8 are Marfield Cottage for Marfield Lane and agenda item 8, Allotment Gardens West, the Anzac's New Ferry. So if anybody does want to leave now, there's now your chance to do so.
Could you just clarify so it doesn't get discussed now then?
Pardon?
So item 8 now doesn't get discussed?
No, item 7 or 8 won't be discussed this evening because we're going to have site visits.
Outline approval for the residential redevelopment of the former playing fields. All
matters are reserved for subsequent approval. This application seeks to establish the principle of residential development. The site is located within the primarily residential area and subject to the criteria of policy HS4 for new housing development being satisfied, residential redevelopment of this site is acceptable in principle. The site comprises of the former Pershaw House school playing fields. The site is now in private ownership and not publicly accessible and is currently vacant and overgrown. The site has not been used since the school closed in 2000. Policy RE5 of the Unitary Development Plan requires that any loss of playing fields, whether public or private, should be compensated for by the provision of replacement facilities that are equivalent or better in both quantity and quality. The site at Glenhaven Road is capable of accommodating two junior-sized pitches. The developer has committed to providing funding through a Section 106 mechanism that could be used to provide replacement facilities of at least equivalent quantity and quality, and Condition 13 seeks to ensure that such replacements are secured as part of details to be submitted and agreed with the local planning authority. The use of this condition, together with the Section 106 agreement, has the support of Sport England, who are a statutory consultee on proposals relating to the development of playing fields. A particular site for replacement facilities has not been identified at this stage, as the Council considers that any commitment to a specific site prior to the completion of the Council's strategic playing fields assessment due by the end of 2016 would not be appropriate. However, the money secured via the 106 agreement would be held by the Council with a commitment to use it for replacement facilities on a nearby suitable site, as agreed with the Council and Sport England, until such time as that strategic review has been completed. Whilst the site is protected for playing fields in the Unitary Development Plan, the site has not been used as such for almost 16 years, and the prospects of it being brought back into use as playing fields, either publicly or privately, are considered to be limited, especially in the absence of any backing from any sports club. The site is not publicly accessible and new residential development is considered to be in keeping with surrounding land use, which is made up of residential properties. The development would also provide for an element of affordable housing at a ratio of 20% on site, and this would also be secured by a Section 106 agreement. In conclusion, it is considered that the site's redevelopment would make a valuable contribution to the Council's housing supply, and although the application is submitted in outline, the Council is satisfied that a detailed scheme could be brought forward that would meet the criteria set out in Policy HS4 for new housing development. Equivalent or better replacement playing fields will be secured via a 106 agreement, and funding required to commit to such replacements would be achieved. It is considered that there are sufficient material considerations to weigh in favour of supporting these proposals, including the provisions made for securing replacement facilities on an alternative site, the provision of new housing, including affordable housing, and the fact that the chances of the site being brought forward for use as a sports ground are considered limited. The application is recommended for approval and there is a qualifying petition of objection.
Would the lead petitioner like to come forward to speak on this?
Okay.
Can I ask you to state your name and how you provide the assistance?
Yeah, my name is Paul Tyler.
Can you just press the on button on the copy?
This application was submitted on the 14th of April 2014, some 22 months ago. There have been six previous applications and two appeals for planning, all of which have been refused. Whilst decisions of the first instance are not binding upon you, it is considered that evidence from appeal decisions are persuasive. You will of course be aware this land was gifted to the borough by Serene Walker as a recreation facility for the children of the community in 1934. the applicant for £7,500, probably in today's terms worth about £20,000, but without land planning permission it's worth over £1 million. It's important for the residents that you read the documents we have placed before you, and also that you really read the planning office report under material policy considerations, all of which we feel have not been overcome. The deeds state that the land was conveyed as an open space and for recreational purposes and not for development. UDT policy indicates that open space contributes to character, irrespective of ownership. On the last appeal, the claims inspectorate stated that the main issue is the effect of the development on the provision of a playing field and open space. So we're not just dealing with the loss of a playing field, we're also dealing with open space. Claims inspectorate clearly indicated on the last appeal that although views are restricted to residents, it nevertheless contributes to the character of the locality through the openness it provides. This is further supported in the conclusion, and obviously that takes into consideration your material policy considerations. Your policy officer says the residents have no right of access. However, the field has been used by local children from the adjacent homes for over 70 years as a recreation facility. In custom law, it could be alleged that there is an easement that has been created because the owners have always allowed this as far as access. Playing fields, the applicant states the land has not been used for 10 years, but this is by design, not choice. The pavilion went on fire and was quickly demolished without being rebuilt. The owners stopped mowing the field, and at that stage, the youth facilities were still used by the children of the borough and also a local martial arts club. Wirral playing pitch strategy clearly indicates a shortage of playing fields. As this pitch is included in that analysis, a replacement would leave Wirral borough council in the same position, so it's inconsistent that it should be moved to housing. The playing field is not genuine service requirements. We have evidence by way of the email from the junior football club sent to the planning department by them, that they've been looking for land for some considerable time. They can't locate any, they have a real need, and they've already identified this land. This is a community club with players and parents with over 1,000 constituents on board. We all know that unless support is organised for children, that they don't get involved. So this is something to, for the community at large. Friends and Law Tennis Association also approached the applicants who have some facilities on the field, but that's refused also. Your planning officer said the land cannot be brought back into use of the playing field, but the claims inspectorate's view was that it could easily be brought back into use. So obviously there's a big conflict there. Planning Policy Guidance 17 says existing open space and land for sport and recreation should not be built on unless assessment is undertaken, and has actually shown that land is surplus requirements. We don't accept this has been achieved. If we can talk about the ground view provision or the 106 agreement, your planning officer said in the site meeting that...
Can I just tell you how long I get that?
Okay. That's the funds are going to be placed, but if you read the actual condition with Sport England, it's quite clear what it means. Sport England have said you cannot place a sports facility with another sports facility. That's like for like, it's just defeating the object. Also, addressed brownfield sites. The Northwest Spatial Strategy 2011 states the best use should be made of existing resources. That is previously developed land, and it's quite clear and unambiguous that recreational facility is not previously developed land. And I'd ask you to read paragraphs 12 and 13 of the last appeal. Wirral Borough Council and National Government has emphasised the need to build more homes on brownfield sites. Policy Guidance 3 again supports this. So to conclude and repeat the claims inspectorate view, the application should be refused by failure to protect an allocated sports ground and open ground from development. And it conflicts with all the
provisions. Sorry, your time's up there.
Just one last slide. As set out in the paragraphs 6 of the bundle. So, you can put the last confession there. Okay. Our board council would also be interested in it.
Thank you very much.
this application, I wrote on two occasions to all the householders surrounding the site, inviting them to meet in small groups and inviting them to attend so that I could listen to any concerns that they may have with regard to a future planning application. I received no invitation to attend these meetings. However, I did receive correspondence by emails or conventional posts indicating their concerns. A significant number of these letters, which are in the planning file, copies of which are, indicated there was reluctance for the field to be returned to use as a playing field. Historically, the junior Glenacre Football Club paid on this land, but sadly, the residents objected, describing it as this created too much noise and disturbed the peace and quiet of the area. If we use a terrible word and cut to the chase, there is but one fundamental reason for the objections to this application, generally known as an acronym, the letters of which spell out, not in my backyard. I can understand this. However, as this application is for outline only, with all matters reserved, I'm still willing to meet with the residents to allay any fears or discuss any future applications. I notice there are an objection signed by many of the immediate residents. However, I did deliver a letter to the planning department personally, so a notice exists, provided by the Prenton Residents and Tenants Association, representing some 800 households. The letter doesn't appear in your preambles or anywhere in the documentation. However, they are anxious to give support, to avail themselves of the potential affordable houses, and also to enjoy the sports facilities that could be released by this matter. There are covenants in favour of Wirral Council on this land, which have been the subject of discussion for some 10 years. And as a consequence of these discussions, the application is before you this evening to see what this land can actually be used for. There's also correspondence from Sports England, who I've engaged in both verbally and by correspondence for 6 years, and who initially objected to this proposal. Those objections have now been removed, and they have agreed with your planning department the various clauses under which they're happy to allow this application to proceed. The condition is that, in fact, two junior-sized football pitches are fundamentally made available on land elsewhere. I am happy to inform you this evening that we have managed to secure land on which these football pitches could be located in the vicinity of the original application site. And in due course, if we have success and are able to go forward, all these details will be made available as part of a subsequent application. Your own professional planning advisors have in fact examined this application, which has been with you for now approaching some 2 years, and found that it satisfies and meets all the statutory legal planning laws. It meets all the present statutory laws revolving around this planning application. I would simply ask... Sorry?
You just have 1 minute there.
Thank you. I would simply ask you to endorse that application. In the event, however, you decide not to, I have sought expert legal counsel's advice on the likelihood of an appeal, and the advice we've received is that there would be a very good chance of a success at this stage. I would hope this would not have to occur, because it would impose on your already overworked planning department additional work. And, of course, in the event of a successful appeal, the fact that this hasn't been...
Can I just ask you, we don't know if there are any grounds for appeal yet, so
no,
I don't
no.
think that that's...
All right. Lady Leader of this committee, I thank you for the attention which you and your committee have afforded to my few words, and I thank you for the time you've made available to me to allow me to make this address. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Is there a law council like to give it? Like to move forward?
My name is Angela Davis, and I'm one of the ward councillors in Prenton Ward. I wish to respectfully challenge a number of points in the report and also in the statements by the applicants and their planning departments. My challenge comes from my personal knowledge of the area and also research and done in conjunction with the residents. The first point around affordable social housing. The site visit made clear that this is not an absolute definitive, as all matters are reserved for subsequent approval. We're aware that Magenta has noted an interest, but this is normal practice that Magenta would use for somewhere of this size.
If that is a factual matter, then I have a conflict of interest. If it's not a factual matter, then I don't. So I'm a full director of Magenta Housing.
Okay, we're not aware of any discussions with Magenta, so I don't think you need to disclose at this stage.
There are plenty of other brownfield sites, and between 1980 and 2011, there's been 6 previous applications and 2 appeals. And I hope you've had the opportunity to look at the appeals that are in the packs there. These have all been turned down. For a number of reasons, they infringe on privacy, and you'll see some of the houses down Glenavon Road do have very small back gardens. I know there's some over the other side that look to have huge back gardens, but you can see on Glenavon Road there's very small back gardens. And also it's been recognised that this community asset should be protected. So I have a concern as a ward council about the loss of green open space and the open playing field for the local community. This land was gifted by Sir Ian Walker in 1934, and such a development is not in the keeping with the spirit of the gift, and I believe would have Sir Ian turning in his grave. It's been a playing field for over 70 years. Pershaw House have been on there. Glenavon Junior Football Club have played in there in their early days. There was a martial arts club there when there was still the pavilion before it burned down. There's also lots of nature there, foxes, birds, bats. All the land has been left to go derelict. Most people that came and saw the site visit the other day, the grass hasn't been mown, it's been left to go derelict. The National Planning Policy Framework says that existing open space, sports and recreational buildings and land, including playing fields, can only be built on if it's surplus to requirements, and an additional replacement of equal or better provision in a suitable location is identified. I would like to clearly say it is not surplus to requirements and there is no suitable additional replacement. The planning report says that whilst the proposal is contrary to the intended use in the unitary development plan, the prospects of bringing the site back into use as a sports ground under private ownership and without the backing of an official club are considered limited. And I'd like to draw your attention to item 4 in the packs that were distributed, which is an email from the treasurer of Glenavon Junior Football Club, which I'd just like to read out to you. So it's saying we are a local junior football club and would object to the planning application on the grounds of inadequate local playing fields for the community of Brighton. Our club began in 1992 and runs teams from age 5 through to an open age team. We predominantly run junior teams and have 264 junior members of the club across 20 teams. Over 90% of our players live in the Brighton area, and there's in excess of 1,000 members of the local community associated with Glenavon Junior Football Club. That's where its name comes from, Glenavon Road. The club has grown considerably and we've now outgrown our current facilities. The current facilities that they use are the Solirac, which is owned by the Solirac Trust, which is leased to the Scouts, and the Scouts kind of kindly let them play there. And also the land at the bottom of Woodchurch Road, which is you know, very boggy, and there's talk about, isn't there, a train station there at some point in the future. So the same about outgrowing their facilities, and their review of local land has identified Pershore House playing fields as the only area for us to potentially use. They're struggling to manage the playing time for the children, having to stagger playing time because of the limited facilities. They've identified funding available to enhance facilities further for children should they acquire a lease in excess of 25 years on these playing fields. This would enable the club to grow and continue to give a safe, secure environment for our local children to engage in football and socialise with their friends. As part of the local community, we would welcome the opportunity to discuss this further. So that's about Clonavon Junior Football Club. There's also unanimous agreement with the residents. I met with the residents, and there's a unanimous agreement for it to return to a playing field. The complaint that the applicants spoke about was people didn't want to have, they were consulted on having floodlights to the field. That's what the residents didn't want because it would have encroached on their privacy. They had asked to meet with the applicant, he has not got back to them to meet with them to discuss it. The Brighton Tenants and Residents Association represents the adjacent area to this area. And I actually met with the chair of the Brighton Tenants and Residents Association just this weekend and shared with him about the offer from the Lane Junior Football Club, and he was in support of that. You will see the Sports England email as well, where it said it's got to be a, you know, no development shall commence until a scheme of equivalent or better provision is found, showing the location, type and size. At the moment, there's no new site that's been identified. Such a site, they're saying, would need to be in the local area, and it would also need to be a new site. It can't be part of an already existing site. Walker Park has been cited as a suitable example in the report. The Friends of Walker Park are, you know, say that the 4.5 people that are supposed to use the park each day, that number is totally wrong. This is a Walker Park is a very well used asset by the local community, by children, by families, by dog walkers, by local churches, by local community groups. And there's also adults that play football on that field. So it's important that, you know, in terms of the Sport England statement, that it would be a new local site that is found. But we're not aware of anywhere that fits that bill. And I know the Brighton area very well. A big concern I have is around traffic. The traffic report, I believe, was done in the afternoon. I have lots of reports from local residents. About that road, the Leighton Road, Cllr Road being used as a rat run. Also Bramall Avenue, which goes down there on the bottom left hand side. There's two very good schools at the end of that road, Prenton Primary and Prenton Junior School. I get a lot of complaints about congestion, parking, and that bit there, the morning, it's you're taking your life in your hands when you turn out. So, you know, if you were to put up to the north 30 houses on there, that would all add to the traffic congestion there. I also want to tie that in with the schools that I've mentioned as well. Prenton Primary, Prenton Junior, excellent, excellent schools. My own children went there. Well, the school is already oversubscribed. So if you're moving in families to that area, they're not going to be able to get into the school. And if they've got to take their children to other schools in the area, say Devonshire Park, for example, that's going to create more traffic in that area. But I also believe that, you know, as children, you have the right to go to your local school because that's where your friends will be. That's, you know, you want to play after school, going out for tea. So I think that's a really important point as well. I've also seen standing water there, there's drainage concerns. Where will this water go? I was speaking to a resident on Friday evening, heard about the electric box being flooded. So to summarise, the concerns that I have are concerns about the loss of the green open space and a playing field for the local community. It is against the spirit of the gift by Sir Ian Walker in 1934 for the land to be purchased for £7,500 in 1984 and then a large private housing development at the expense of the children and families of the local community. It is not surplus to requirements. Glenavon Junior Football Club, fully supported by the residents, would like to use the playing field. There are no suitable local alternatives to the site. I've also mentioned the concerns about traffic, drainage, and I think very importantly the school being oversubscribed as well. So it is for these reasons that I respectfully ask the planning committee to decline this application and instead do the right thing and support the local community. Thank you.
I will be moving refusal later when everybody's had their say. I will be moving refusal on this, Chair. Obviously, you've heard quite a bit about the history about it's been the playing field for 70 years and it's basically been abandoned on purpose and left to go to rack and ruin. And now we see the state it is on the site visit. But what this letter saying, the email from Glenavon Fields, the football club, saying that they have got money that will bring that back into use as a playing field that they've used for a long, long time.
Yeah.
And you know, for 70 years to just to leave it to go to rag and ruin just to make some extra money is a bit of a disgrace, really. But I will be moved from refusal, but I'll listen to what everybody else has got to say on the thing first. Thank you, Chair.
Okay, Steve.
Yeah, I mean, it really is a difficult one, isn't it? And, not really difficult to get residents out here because I quite prefer to have an open aspect to agree on my property and protect that as best I could. So I have a great deal of sympathy with residents. Also, the principle of the playing field issue has been tested fairly recently, and one of my questions being posed is really in 2011, as I look at this appeal decision in the past year. Has anything changed so dramatically in the housing legislation or in the sort of planning legislation that would make us take a different view? Now, presuming professional officers have took all those things into account and have come to the view that the world is a different place than it was when tested in 2011. So that's a dilemma for me as a member of the planning committee listening to our professionals. However, there is no hard evidence of another identified site that would allow me to say, well, if it goes to appeal, they will simply go to appeal and point to site X or site Y or site Z, whatever. And that gives me a dilemma that is there sufficient grounds? I haven't heard any reasons for refusal yet, so I'll hold my keep a power of pride, but is there any mileage in this being tested again, either through the appeal or whatever system? And in the absence of a hard passed alternative site, I guess residents and local ward councils believe they have enough to go to an appeal with, whether that's the view or not. I didn't take very kindly to the veiled threat about if you go to appeal, this, that, and whatever will happen. Well, we don't take particularly kindly to that as members of the planning committee. We do listen very hard to what people say. I also know the world has changed because the demand for housing, both at national level, has increased and there's a big drive to build more properties. and locally there's a drive to build more properties. We are part of the national planning agenda, so it really is a difficulty. And what would be the worst that could happen? We go to appeal, it stays dormant for a longer period, and then it comes back in a few years. It may just be whatever's moved as a stay of execution rather than the final results. But my view is, I'll listen to what we're using the refusal for, but it really is a difficult planning dilemma for everyone around the state. I hope residents and the developer appreciate that.
Okay, can I take Phil and then Dave?
Thank you, Chair. My question is really for the officers, and it follows on from what Steve just said about whether or not if this is refused, this can be a stay of execution. Would we struggle to defend this appeal or anything else were the applicant to actually identify an area where a complaint field conflicts?
We don't actually have the grounds for refusal yet, so it'd be difficult for people to comment on that at the moment.
It was hypothetical, I understand that. Once
we know what the grounds for refusal are, then we might be able to comment.
Okay, well let me change my point slightly.
Sorry, through you, Chair. In respect of that, it would be very difficult for us to prejudge any appeal anyway. One, we don't know what the grounds would be. But I can't speak for the inspector and what view that he might have, or she, at any appeal. So I wouldn't want to prejudge or predetermine any appeal, if indeed an appeal was to come forward. What I would say is, I think Councillor Foulkes mentioned it, the previous appeal, some of the policies that are identified in there are no longer applicable. The regional spatial strategy was revoked in 2011. Some of the planning policy guidance notes that are referred to no longer stand. So planning policy has moved forward since then. But I wouldn't want to prejudge any appeal.
And my final question, it's a bit of a technical one, but it's for me anyway. Sports in secondary school shall commence. But this is for outline permission, so would that qualify as a scheme and
there are two issues here, really. The first is that the council is currently undertaking a revised and updated assessment of its sports pitches and its open space. And as part of that process, we didn't feel it was appropriate to identify a replacement site until that assessment had concluded, which hopefully will be at the end of this year. Having said that, there was nothing to prevent the applicant coming forward with this application and saying there is an alternative that we have in mind, and we would have tied that through the Section 106 agreement. That didn't come forward as part of this application. And as we've outlined in the report, as I outlined in my presentation, and as the objector made reference to, Sport England and our own planning policies require replacement facilities. So if we're losing the equivalent of two junior pitches, you would expect that equivalent two junior pitches to be replaced elsewhere within the local community.
Okay, Dave.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Having been on the site visit, which I found very interesting to go on, just a couple of comments really which I think might be valid. First of all, the objector's document does rely an awful lot on the existence of restrictive covenants. I think we have to make it clear to the applicant and to the audience that this planning committee cannot get involved in the application or otherwise of restrictive covenants. These are matters for civil law which need to be undertaken by those who believe they are aggrieved by whatever decision is made. So can we dismiss, please, question about covenants as we cannot consider it. If we were to try and refuse this application on the ground that covenants have been broken, it would immediately be overturned at appeal. Second point, comment has been made about whether we should retain this land as some sort of sports facility. Having looked at the site, one would like to say yes, it's a lovely area, it's overgrown, but wouldn't it be nice to have it as a sports facility? The problem is that nobody has attempted create a sports facility there for very many years. There didn't seem to be any particular promotion, if you like, for that time. And we are obliged as a planning committee not to think what might be done with this land if we don't approve it tonight. tonight. What we have to consider is this application on its merits and nothing else. A comment has already been made concerning changes in the law since a lot of this documentation that we've been provided with was produced. There's great pressure on the borough, as you will all know, to put additional housing in the area, and I think in general this committee would always support the production of additional housing for people to live in, because that is very, very important. So with those comments, I think we just have to bear in mind that here we are looking at this specific application to see if we believe this is a suitable solution, bearing in mind that nothing has happened on this site for so long. I'd like to hear what other people have to say, but I must admit I'm on the fence at the moment concerning whether to approve the officer's recommendations or to try and follow whatever reason might be put forward for refusal. Thank you.
Dave.
Thank you, Chair. And also, I also attended the site visit. It was worthwhile to see the actual site. Listen to the arguments put forward both by the objectors and the ward councillor. And I think two of the things that really come out in the report, of course, most of the points that we made are in conditions 11 and 13, which relates to section 106 agreement in 11 in relation to nothing will happen until the football pitches are found. And 13, a complete report in relation to drainage and those sort of problems in relation to water treatment. That was one of the first questions I asked myself personally, because we know quite well the topography of that particular part of the borough, the problems water plays with our community. I would dearly like to listen to the reasoned argument for refusal, because reading through the report, I can't see any myself. But I would like to hear some from somebody else. Thank you.
Treena, did you want to come back?
It was just a point, really, to Councillor Elderton's comments before. He just said that there has been no interest really to turn this facility back into a community sports facility. But looking at the email that we've received from Glen Avon Junior Football Club to say that they would, should they acquire a lease in the excess of 25 years, you know, they would be able to grow and continue a safe environment for their children to engage in football. What is the likelihood of this lease being granted? Has anybody answered that? Or is that?
Supporting Councillor Realey.
Without him?